mentre il sole del mattino si spingeva nelle case.
Hello everybody, thank you very much for joining us here tonight at the Book Shack. We are very lucky to have a taping of Melissa's Menu from PAC Television. We are also extremely lucky to have a very great author with us here tonight, Sarah Fioroni. Thank you for coming all the way from Italy. We also have a free wine tasting tonight from Pilgrim Wine and Spirits. You guys can go visit Tony and taste some of Sarah's delicious wine if you'd like. Just a reminder, because we are taping the show tonight, if you could just please make sure your cell phones are on vibrate. Other than that, we are ready for a great show. Thank you very much for coming.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Melissa's Menu. Who here has been watching the show? Raise of hands. Oh, nice. I have some followers. Excellent. Well, as you can tell, this isn't your normal setup for Melissa's Menu. We're taping live tonight at the Book Shack at the Kingston Mall. So thanks everyone for stopping by. I do have two special guests tonight on the show. Again, Sarah Fioroni and Tony Colantonio from Pilgrim Wine and Spirits. Sarah is an executive chef, cooking instructor, sommelier, and manager of her family's farm in Italy. Their farm is actually an all-organic farm located in the center of Tuscany. She'll be given a brief description of her new cookbook, sharing stories about her family's farm, and of course talking to us about her family's vineyard as well. After that, she'll be signing her new cookbook, which is right here. It's called The Family Farm in Tuscany. Make sure you pick up a copy tonight and she'll sign that for you.
Sarah is a native of Italy. She's worked full-time at her family's farm since graduating high school. Now she's the farm's general manager and executive chef, and she's also a certified sommelier. You'll have to excuse me, I don't speak Italian very well. In addition to studying tourism and economy at the University of Florence, she teaches cooking classes at the farm, and in the U.S. she appears at food and wine events to conduct demonstrations and workshops as well. So Sarah, I have a couple questions for you. First off, you have a number of talents. Is there anything that you don't do?
I don't date George Clooney. That's the only things I don't do, and I would like to do that.
Well, I'm with you there in that way. Can you please tell us, please tell the audience about your upbringing and how the farm came into existence?
Yeah, well, everything started in 1955. My parents were farmers from generation, and they came in Tuscany, in San Gimignano, actually, where the farm is located today. And they were sharecropper from generation, and they started to be sharecropper in Tuscany. And this was all after the Second World War, so everything was really hard, and they started to work in Tuscany to find better opportunity there. And they actually bought the property in the 71, and they had only 50 acres at that time, and today we have 250 acres. Wow. So,
okay. Now, the town that it's located in, that's in the heart of Tuscany?
Yeah, it's in the middle of Tuscany. It's in San Gimignano, just 10 minutes by car from San Gimignano, and we are in between Siena and Florence.
Okay. Now, what types of fruits and vegetables do you grow at the farm?
We have we grow up seasonal vegetable and fruits. We have like winter vegetable like spinach and cauliflower and fennel. Summertime, a lot of tomato, any kinds of salad and zucchini, eggplant, pepper. So many different.
Excellent.
Variety.
So a little bit of everything there.
Yeah.
Except for avocados.
Yeah, except for avocado that I love it. We don't grow at the farm.
Now, when did the farm become organic? I know that I was reading in your cookbook. And
yeah, that's a
organic.
Good question, because we were organic forever, and there was just a little bit of changing around the 70s. Where a bee farmer was very hard. It was very hard time for my family and for many other farmers in Italy and in the world. So they had to use some pesticide when they had some disease, some insect or bugs. But finally, about 18 years ago, we decided to go back to our origin and to be organic 100%.
Excellent.
So it was something like, you know, it wasn't a business decision or a marketing decision. It was just to be back to our region, how we were in the 1955.
And organic's so big these days, it's really important to a lot of
people. It's really important. Yeah. And it's not only about don't use chemical compost or pesticide, it's also about respecting the season, so grow only seasonal products, and also have all this variety of insects that really help you in the farm, in the organic farm, and be sustainable is so important.
Mm-hmm. Now, speaking of the farm, what is the name of your farm?
It's Fattoria Poggio a Loro.
Okay, I'm not going to try to say that.
And the meaning of the name is Fattoria means farm, Poggio means hill, and a Loro is bay leaf tree. So it should be like the hill of the bay leaf tree hill.
Okay, excellent. Now, I read that you do offer group tours and lodging, so can you expand a little bit on that?
Yeah, we have a lot of groups. They are coming every day at the farm, and they usually do a wine tasting and a tour of the farm, so we can show them which are our production. So if we don't have the people just doing the wine tasting, we wanted to show all the farms so we can explain better what we grow up and what does it mean be organic. And also we have 11 double rooms, and so we have a few people staying at the farm, and we have also breakfast, lunch, and dinner, so we have a restaurant. So
excellent.
Now, there is something's going on every day.
Right. Do they all eat together? Is it like a family atmosphere where they all eat at the same table, kind of like a bed and breakfast?
Yeah, it's a family atmosphere, so they have breakfast and dinner and lunch all together in the same table. Sometimes we have the chance to sit with them, sometimes we are just working and talking to them, so it's very nice.
That's fabulous. Yeah. Don't you all want to check out the farm? Actually, I think a few of you have been to her farm, correct? Raise of hands, excellent.
Wow.
Sarah has quite the following. Now, I also read that you have a store on site. Now, what do you sell in the store?
Yeah, we sell all our products, like pasta, cookies, extra virgin olive oil, wine, and then saffron, grappa, vinsanto. And actually, we also produce other things, as I told you, like vegetable, fruits, eggs, meat. But we don't sell all these things in the store because we use for our restaurant and our family.
Okay. Now, just a quick question, kind of off track. The extra virgin olive oil, you make that right at the farm?
Yeah, we have 1,500 olive tree at the farm, so we make the extra virgin olive oil.
Okay. Yeah. Now, can we actually go online to purchase some of your products?
So far, you can write me an email so I can send all the price with all the information for the shipping and the price of the products. And hopefully, in a very few months, it will be available also online. The website is there, but we are doing little changing, so we will be able to sell online.
Excellent. Now, my favorite part, tell the audience about your family's vineyard and about the wines, because they'll be trying some of the wines tonight.
Yes, so we have a wine cellar. We have 50 acres of vineyard, and we produce 8 different kinds of wine, 3 white and 5 red, and the total production is 200,000 bottles of wine every year. So, and our wine so far is available in Maine and hopefully in Massachusetts pretty soon.
Oh, Maine. That's where I'm from. To order some.
That's good.
Ship it to my parents' house. Now, when did the idea of doing a cookbook become something that you thought that you could do?
Yeah, well, everything started with the idea that I wanted to write down the history of my family and all the beautiful job that they did at the farm. So I just want to put down some information to share with everybody. And then after that, I started to teach cooking class in Texas in 2006. And everybody started to ask me about, do you have your cookbook? Where is your cookbook? And I asked, I asked to my good friends, Johnny Weber, that she's from San Antonio, I asked, why all these people are asking about my cookbook? I mean, we don't have cookbook in Italy. Everybody know how to cook.
Right.
And she said, you don't know why they are asking you that? Okay, come with me. So she showed me in a bookstore the section about cookbook. And I was really impressed about how many cookbooks you have here. So she said, you really should write a cookbook with your recipe and the story of the farm, all the information that you know about the farm, about the olive oil, about the wine. And I started to write a cookbook. And actually, as you see, the book today is a mix of stories of the family about what's going on every month of the farm. And with 50 Tuscan recipes, so it's a mix of, you can read the book if you don't cook, or you just cook and don't read the book because you don't like to read. You can do everything you want.
Right.
But still, the most important part in this book is the first chapter, where you can find the story of my family. So my father and his two brothers, they moved from Marche to Tuscany in the 55, and all their hard work. I needed to share with everybody because sometimes it's hard when we have people at the farm and I just meet the people for 5 minutes, it's hard to share with them their story. And this is the most important thing because it's a way to say thanks to my parents for all the wonderful and hard work that they did for us. For the young generation, they give us a house, a place to live and a beautiful place to work and a very good and healthy product. So I think is the best gift that the parents can give to a child.
That's wonderful.
Thank you.
I can't wait to try.
Thank you.
Now, when did you take over the main kitchen duties from your mother and from your aunts?
Well, it's always hard to be in the kitchen when my mother and my aunts are around.
Right.
I started to cook when I was actually 3 or 4. I started to put my hands on. And actually, I started to work full-time when I was 20, and now I'm 32, so. But it's still hard. I have always my mother behind and say, no, cook more, cook less, more extra virgin olive oil.
Yeah.
And I say, Mom, I know what I'm doing. Come on.
What's your favorite food or favorite meal to prepare?
Well, I think my favorite food is pasta. I'm Italian, so one of my favorite recipes is the homemade pasta because you really do everything by yourself. You don't just buy a package of pasta and you cook, but you make your own pasta with the eggs. So I think any kinds of pasta, tagliatelle, lasagne, any kinds of pasta, yeah.
So if I come to the farm, will you teach me how to make pasta?
Absolutely,
I've never
yes.
made pasta before. Yeah. I've always wanted to. What's your favorite time of year at the farm?
My favorite one, I think, is May. Because we goes from those colors, they are kind of a brown, yellow. We say goodbye to the autumn and winter time. And in few days when we have rain, everything turn into a beautiful green color. The flowers start to bloom, so it's a beautiful time of the year. But also another favorite time is when we have snow. It's such a magical moment at the farm when we have the snow. We have very few time at the year, but it's amazing.
Now, you have so many visitors from all over the different countries that come to visit your farm, and I'm sure a lot of them speak different languages. What languages are you fluent in?
Yeah, I hope I'm fluent in English.
You do a great job speaking.
Thank you. I speak French and a little bit of German.
Oh, French as well.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent.
And Italian, of course.
And what's a typical day entail at the farm?
Well, what's going on at the farm is that we wake up pretty early. The rest of my family, the members that work in the fields and work with the animals, they wake up earlier than me. Mm-hmm. But we start talking about the B&B. We start with breakfast, okay. And we have some checkout during the morning. Then we start right away doing the tour of the farm, wine tasting, beautiful lunch done with our products. And then in the afternoon, we have more check-in and check-out. And, of course, I have to do all the office stuff, you know. And we started pretty soon around 4 to make the dinner ready for the guests for the dinner. And we have so many things going on. That's the operation at the B&B, but we have, you know, some day we have some cows that deliver baby cows, or some day we have harvest. So it's always exciting.
So do you ever sleep?
No.
How can the audience contact you if they have they have any questions? Do you have a website you could give them?
Yeah, I have a website. It's www.fattoriapoggialoro.com. I know that.
Which, by the way, is right here in the cookbook.
Yeah, so you just need to put www and the name of the farm that you can find on my business card and on the book, and then ed.com, and we'll be done.
Excellent. Thank you, Sarah, so much for joining us tonight. What we're going to do next, we have a couple things going on tonight. Sarah and I are going over to the counter. The cupcake shack counter over there. We're going to make one of her appetizers in the cookbook called
bruschetta
with tomato
with
and basil.
With tomato and basil, yeah.
And then after that, she'll be signing her cookbook over here, and then we'll have Tony offering the wine tasting as well. So a few of you, if you want, can start doing the wines. A few of you, if you want to watch us make the appetizer, feel free to stop over. Any questions so far? Great. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you. Thank you, Melissa. Thank you.
mentre il sole del mattino si spingeva nelle case. Io seguivo il suo ricordo con la punta delle mani. Il profumo delle rose dura solo una stagione, poi si perde tra le cose ed è così che persi lei. Si voltò, mi voltai. Non seppe mai che morivo di lei, che avrei voluto fermarla, ma poi seppi capire che il gioco degli anni ci rese distanti.
So hello again, everyone. Thanks for coming over to watch. So we're going to be preparing one of Sarah's appetizers. Can you tell them the name again?
Yeah, the bruschetta with tomato and basil.
Red.
It's a very simple recipe that you can make in 5-10 minutes, no more than that. You can make as an appetizer. And we have a white bread. You can find Italian bread or just a regular white bread. And we are going to grill the bread. Then we have fresh garlic, tomato, basil, extra virgin olive oil, and fine salt and pepper.
So very easy. Anyone can make this, right?
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
Okay. So what do I start doing? You've got some tomatoes chopped. We've got the bread chopped.
Yeah. First of all, I will grill the bread. So what we are doing is basically cutting the basil with our hands. We are not going to use any knife because otherwise the basil will turn black, dark right away, and will lose most of the flavor. So don't be afraid if the little pieces are not the same. It's a great idea to do always with your finger, with your fingers and with your hands.
Okay, I didn't realize that. I normally just do a rough chop. So what you're saying is it will turn black
exactly.
faster?
Exactly, turn very black very fast,
okay.
And it loses most of the flavor. So this is something that my mother teach me.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. And basil goes so well with any sort of Italian dish, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Do you grow any fresh herbs such as, besides basil in the...
Yeah, we have rosemary, we have sage, we have timo, I don't know how to say it in English.
Timo.
And timo is thyme. Yeah.
Oh, thyme.
Thyme. And then we have also the bay leaf tree. We use some of the bay leaf leaves for some special recipe, like the wild boar. So.
Great. Does anyone have any questions so far about the cookbook or any of the recipes or anything like that?
How old are your olive trees?
Well, no older than 1985, because we have a big frozen in Italy, a big storm and frost, sorry. And all the old olive tree died that year. It was
they
a very...
long.
Sorry?
They live very long, right?
Yeah, they can live 1,000 years with no problem. And we had a very old olive tree at the farm. So I was little in the 85, but when I say that what happens that year, it's almost cry every time because they had such a beautiful, huge olive tree at the farm and we don't have this anymore because all are from the 85 or recent.
It's like losing a family member.
It's like losing a family member, right? Because they are so beautiful when they're old.
Yes.
The vineyard can live only a short time compared to the olive tree, only about 35 years. There are some examples of vineyard that can live even more and produce grapes, like in France or some place in Italy, where you can find a vineyard 80, 85 years old, even more. But usually the main rules is 30, 35 years, and then you have to replant a new vineyard. Yeah.
Yes?
Can you tell us a little bit about the cattle? Because I understand you have wonderful steaks at your farm.
Yeah, it's true. On Saturday now we cook special steak. It's a Fiorentina T-bone steak.
Oh.
And this one comes from the Chianina cattle. Chianina is a special breed that we have in Tuscany, and this is one of the oldest breed in the world. It exists since the Roman age, so a long time ago.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah, and the meat is so special. It's rich in protein, low fat, and it's very tasty.
Excellent. Now, which wines would go best with this appetizer?
I would suggest, as it is an appetizer, I would start with the white wine. So if you have a full meal or you just have an aperitifs, I will not start with the red, but I will start with the white wine. So maybe later when you have pasta and meat, you can go and right. drink some bread.
So just like a light wine, yeah, a light white wine.
I would suggest, of course, Vernaccia, because it's the wine that comes from my area, from my town,
right.
and from my farm too. But of course, you can match also some other kinds of wine like Chardonnay or Pinot Gris or Sauvignon Blanc.
Okay. Yeah. Let me just take a quick peek on the bread.
So now that the bread is ready, we have to finish to our preparation with the tomato and basil. We are going to add the salt and pepper.
Okay. And what kind of salt are we using, Sarah?
I love this, the fine salt. The fine sea salt is my favorite. So we are going to add the salt.
Gives it a better flavor, don't you think? Yeah, it stands out more.
One pinch of black pepper and a lot of extra virgin olive oil.
From your farm, of course.
From my farm. So, of course, good information about the extra virgin olive oil, that is a vegetable fat. So, of course, I understand it is a fat, but I really suggest to substitute always the extra virgin olive oil instead of butter. So you can use the extra virgin olive oil. And the good question will be, Sarah, they have the same calories, like butter and extra virgin olive oil, they have exactly the same calories. It's true. But the extra virgin olive oil is more easy to be digested by our body. So absolutely it's more healthy. It helps your digestion. It helps your cholesterol. So it's absolutely a healthy thing to have on your diet instead of butter and margarine. Even the Romans that were using the extra virgin olive oil has a lotion for the skin and the hair. So
she's full of information, right?
You can find also this and more information in the cookbook.
Yeah. Now, what's the difference between a regular olive oil versus an extra virgin olive oil?
Yeah, this is something very important. Sometimes the label of the extra virgin olive oil or olive oil is a little bit confusing. I wanted to tell you the difference. Extra virgin olive oil is always the first press of the olives and low acidity. This is the same rules for all the country in the European community. The acidity must be less than 0.8%. If it's more, you are not allowed anymore to put the name extra virgin olive oil on the label.
Oh,
so that's
okay.
very important. So when you pick extra virgin olive oil label, you know that it is a first press, low acidity. Those are the very two important information. But you can, as a producer, you can even repress the same olives and you will make the virgin olive oil. You can repress another time, so the third time, the olives to make the olive oil. So that's the difference. But you can understand that the third press of the olives is not really good because all the juice, the main nutrition goes in the first press, in the extra virgin olive oil. So absolutely, that's my suggestion. You always need to buy the extra virgin olive oil. And even if it's organic, even better. So.
Excellent. Very useful information.
So when the bread is grilled, you wrap the fresh garlic on the bread. Sorry. Just a little bit to give the flavor. If you like, you can do a little bit more than this. And then I will use the plate.
Okay.
Thank you.
So this is actually very fast to make this appetizer.
Absolutely. And I will put our toppings, the tomato and basil,
okay.
on the top.
Now, are those going back in the oven, or are we done with that after?
No, it's done.
Okay.
But I'm going to suggest to add a little bit of extra virgin olive oil on the top.
Okay. So I'll do that part.
Yeah, thank you.
I feel like I'm not helping at all. I kind of like this. So just kind of drizzle it on top.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay.
And the bruschetta.
Oh, beautiful. Excellent. Let's make a couple others.
We'll fix more for you now.
Mm-hmm. Is there a reason why you rather scrape it on top of the bread versus cut it? I don't know.
Yeah, you can, at least you can cut in two, but it's hard then to rub on the yeah, we don't chop the garlic, you just rub on the bread, you give a little bit of flavors, otherwise it's too much. So the garlic is already pretty strong, but we wanted to feel the flavors of tomato, basil, and the extra virgin olive oil. So, of course, I love garlic, but I will not exaggerate it in this recipe, so you can still will be able to test it, the flavors of the extra virgin olive oil, and that's a good thing.
We've just got about one more minute, so we're going to do one more over here, and then we'll move over so Sarah can start signing her cookbooks, and Tony can start the wine tasting as well. Oh, question for you. What type of tomatoes would we normally use for this type of bruschetta?
The Roma tomato.
The Roma, okay. Yeah. Now, why is that? Any particular reason?
They're usually more easy to cut, and the shape of the tomato is perfect for this recipe. You can even do like with the cherry tomato, but it takes more time, so it's more easy to do with the Roma tomato.
Okay, excellent.
Want a couple of extra slices?
Okay. So if we have a couple volunteers that would like to try. Todd, come on over. Oh, Todd's up for anything.
I'll try it.
Gotta have it.
We have one of our faithful watchers of Melissa's Menu, Phil, right here. Mm-hmm. Let us know what you think.
Thank you.
Mentre il sole delle due stava alto su Firenze, sedevamo a un ristorante verso il punto del caffè. L'orologio disse andiamo, l'aiutai con le valigie. Lei che disse ci scriviamo, io sorrisi e dissi ciao. Si voltò, mi voltai.
Folks, we have with us Tony from Pilgrim Wine and Spirits, and he's going to give a brief description of the two wines that we're trying tonight. So, Tony, what are we trying? What are the guests trying?
Tonight, we're trying Sarah's Vernaccia, which is a light body with a nice, crisp finish.
Goes excellent with any type of light sauces, chicken, fish.
Okay, and what about the red wine?
Is a San Gimignano Rosso Convivio, which is a blend of Sangiovese 95% and 5% Cabernet, so you have a very soft beginning and a nice dry finish.
Okay. Now, what kind of meats or dishes would go well with the red wine?
With the red wine, you would like a steak, a red sauce, pasta. It's very versatile.
Okay, excellent. And now you're located right on Exit 5, correct?
Yes, right off Exit 5, right across from Home Depot.
Okay, what are your hours at Pilgrim Wine and Spirits?
Monday through Thursday, 9 to 9. Friday, Saturday, 9 to 10. Sunday, 12 to 6.
Excellent. And I'm going to actually borrow your microphone. We have a guest that I'm very curious to see what he thinks of the white that he just tried. Todd, what do you think?
I'm not a wine drinker, but this finishes beautifully. I'm going to have to get a bottle.
Excellent. We have another guest, Tony, who's going to try the red.
Okay.
And Tony's also Italian, by the way, so he's perfect for this. Tony, let us know.
And I'm the right height, right?
Take a sip and let us know what you think.
It's fantastic.
Okay.
Recommend it highly.
Lei vive un tempo che leggi non ha, vola seguendo una linea che sembra dettata dal vento. Tu puoi seguirla soltanto un po'. Mentre il sole della sera si prendeva i suoi colori, io pensavo è stato giusto.
That's all the time we have tonight, folks. Thank you so much for joining us for another episode of Melissa's Menu. Thanks again to Sarah for coming. And again, if you could just tell the viewers one more time the website address.
Yes, it's www.fattoriapoggialoro.com.
Excellent. Join us next week, folks, to see what's cooking up on Melissa's Menu. Good night.
Si voltò, mi voltai. Si voltò. And I'm kidding.